Next up, we have Kelly Hogan, who I guess whose official title is the Director of Instructional Innovation. Okay. And you all have your handouts.
I need one, actually.
There you go.
All right. So I really don't give talks anymore because I really feel like I need to model instruction the way that we are really pushing for it in the classroom. And so we'll just do it. What I'd like you to do with the note card that I handed to you is to put on one side of it a couple of reasons why you think students leave the STEM fields as undergraduates. It may be a feeling you had as an undergraduate, or you may have friends that started science majors with you and left. So anything you can dig up as to why you think students leave STEM.
The question is why they don't go into graduate school, or
why they leave science majors. So
Okay.
There's a large group of students that start their college degree intending to be science majors,
okay.
And roughly half of them leave nationally. Brainstorm there. If you will shuffle the cards around the room, so pass it to somebody who passes it to someone, you should pass maybe three or four times and end up with a card that's not your own. One of the techniques that's a very low-tech technique to use in any size classroom. Often when you ask students to volunteer and to answer a question, you get very few students that would be willing to do that, and they eventually tend to be the same people from the front row. There's a lot of bias involved, and they often tend to be majority white, male students that do this. So one way to equalize the opportunities for all students in the classroom is to have everybody participate first by writing. And this idea of not wanting to participate because you feel like you might be wrong is very strong in students, especially novices. And so now that you've shuffled, you certainly could collaborate and talk. We could spend time doing that. But you also now see somebody else's answers. And now you're just the reporter of those answers. So will somebody report what's on their card for us, and we'll just look at a few cards. Find the class is difficult.
Male-dominated field unfriendly to women.
Okay, a male-dominated field unfriendly to women.
Less motivated, boring classes.
Boring classes.
High requirement of credit hours.
Yeah, high credit hour requirements.
Science classes leave no time for personal life or other interests.
No time for personal life. They're comparing themselves to other majors, probably.
Not a great fit.
What was that?
Not a great fit.
Not a great fit.
Not a great fit. Okay. So maybe finding it difficult or not interested.
Yeah, I got heavier course requirements for workload in STEM courses.
Okay, so yeah, certainly students feel like they're working harder than a lot of their majors. And also this idea of maybe it not being a friendly environment, and that certainly holds true for certain groups more than others, our underrepresented minority students, women in certain disciplines, right? They feel it's highly competitive. A lot of the blame often goes to the instructor as well. Students can't relate to that person in front of them. Maybe they're not a role model that looks like them. They often are delivering a lot of content. It's not relevant to their lives. They're being forced to memorize a lot of material. And students that got into science for the joy of discovery often find that they just have to memorize a lot, and that's not really what we know scientists do, right? So we often don't get to see the creative side of science in the first few years of these degrees until they go into a more hands-on experiential situation. All right, so that leads us to reforming education, and I've been involved with this for many years now. And Leslie touched on some of the ideas of these redesigned classes. We've been working with some of the really large lectures. How many of you were in a large lecture when you were in college? Okay. Large is relative to people. To some people, that's 50. I teach 430 students at a time. There are schools that easily teach 800 to 1,000 students at a time. But we've made a lot of changes in these large lecture classes, and we know that if we can do it in a class that big, we can certainly do it in smaller classes as well. So I've listed some of the major elements for you, and I'll run through them kind of quickly, but one really important principle is that we need to make the learning that they're going through relevant to their lives. Why should they care about it? That's a lens to start your teaching with. Why should they care? And in fact, there are some evidence that this relevancy issue is even more important to underrepresented minority students. Give students practice with authentic scientific thinking skills. This relates back to the cures that Leslie was talking about, but also in the classroom. We don't have to tell students a lot of content. We can ask them to creatively think about information. So design an experiment, hypothesize, make a prediction. That's much higher thinking level, and you're doing what scientists are actually doing. You can give introductory students a set of data and ask them to make a conclusion from it. We often don't do that with our students. We often just deliver a lot of content and tell them what's on the slide instead of asking them what's on the slide. So a common mantra within this kind of teaching is ask, don't tell, and always start with this question that students can practice thinking like scientists. Have high expectations, but clear ones. So, I don't know if any of you are currently teaching, but if you've ever started designing a course, you often start with the book and the topics. Education specialists would not approve. Start with backwards design. You start with what is it that you want the students to learn, right? You start with thinking about what the assessment would look like and plan backwards from there. So having really clear objectives is something we've been working on. Not as easy as it sounds sometimes when we've not been teaching that way, but this gives really clear objectives to the students. The expectations before they even begin this class, the objectives are on a syllabus. They know if this is a good class for them, as opposed to a short description on a syllabus. They walk in, they find out 3 weeks into the class this was not at all what they thought it was, and they're in over their head, right? So expectations become really important to students. I'll also say that I hear stories all the time from students, often underrepresented minority students, who say, my guidance counselor said I shouldn't be a science major because I could never do it. They get this all the time. So you having high expectations for a student is what that student wants. They want to know that you have high expectations, but you're going to help them get there. And so all this instructor language to say, I know you can do it, and I'm going to help you get there, and we can convey that in lots of different ways, that's the right way to work with students. I kind of touched on backwards design already. All in all, the way we're describing a lot of these classes, there's a lot of terminology for it, but the most general way to think about it is to move away from an instructor-centered classroom. Our classrooms are often designed that way. So everybody's facing this way. There's one place that the instructor's supposed to stand. It's instructor-centered, who is then delivering content, right? Has anybody been in Greenlaw 101 on campus? Greenlaw 101. It's a new classroom for 100 students that they've renovated. There is no front of the classroom. There are four walls, The chairs are all on wheels with desks attached. They can be brought together to make small tables. They can be turned in different directions. There are computer screens all around. It's hard to say that that classroom is instructor-centered when the instructor is just walking up and down the aisles, right? That means the focus is on the students to be collaborating and discussing with each other. So as soon as you turn your class from content delivery to asking questions to students, they then have something to do, and that would be a student-centered classroom. Teach as scientists should. If you're using a lot of assessment where you're asking questions all the time, that means you have a lot of data about your students, whether it's walking around and just listening to what they're saying, if you're using technology or collecting note cards from students, you constantly have all these data about what students know and what they don't know. You can change your teaching on the fly, you can keep it for next semester to know how you're going to change your teaching, but it also means that students have a lot of that data as well. They're constantly checking in, what do I know, what do I don't know, right? So we say, teach like a scientist would. Don't just teach and assume everybody learned. Ask yourself, how do I know if these students are learning? And I've worked with instructors who have a lot of aha moments. The first time they do this one act of learning activity where they ask a question either by technology or like I did with a note card, and none of the answers come back the way they expect them to, right? They have to face this idea that people aren't really learning what they think they're learning and really think about how do I break that learning into steps, right? So it's much more informative. And then lastly, embracing diversity with a mindset that everyone has the potential to become a scientist. It's surprising how many faculty still believe our job is to weed out students, to not become scientists, to not become the future doctors of America. And we really need to change that mindset that we really want all students to succeed and we will help them get there. And that's called the growth mindset that we really try and not just have, but explicitly show to students with the words we use in the classroom as well, continually. All right, so actually Leslie did a great job giving you an overview of a lot of the types of things that are going on campus related to teaching and learning, and I can go through some of those again or in greater depth. I participated a lot in the QEP, so that's why there is a lot of overlap there. But before we do that, I think it's also helpful for you to think backwards a little bit. Maybe you don't know what's out there, maybe you don't know how you'll get there, but I think it's useful for you to think about who it is that you want to impact, and maybe what your initial passions are. And I might be able to help connect you, or anybody in these next few groups might be able to help connect you. It's okay that you don't know everything that's going on, but you're going to be happier if you're working on something you're passionate about. So I'm going to ask you to take a moment or two and answer those next two questions.
They're looking for the answer in the paper, but it's not there. Yeah. You've got to think a little bit. Yeah. I think this is the point.
Mm-hmm. All right. Do you want to come back together? It's a great conversation you guys are having. I hope that you share information with each other and keep it up and inspire each other. Does anybody want to share something with the group? I think this will probably help Denise, too, because she's going to have overlap with some of this, too, especially if you're thinking K through 12 or pipeline. You were all just so talkative. See what happens in a classroom? I heard a lot of really great talking over here. Would one of you share what you were talking about?
We were discussing our interest in, our passion about sort of the lack of diversity, right, in the STEM fields. You have very few underrepresented minorities, few women, few first-generation undergraduates, and somehow, because they don't have the role models and there's nothing really in place to keep them, because many times they don't come as well prepared, they sort of fall through the cracks and you don't even know it, right? So somehow, at least, we're passionate about sort of trying to increase the diversity. And I think sort of also at the K through 12 level, because it's really there where they prepare students, right? And so when they come in, if you have students who have very different levels of preparation, how are they going to compete with each other, right?
So, and I'll say that these redesigned classes, they help level the playing field, and that's why they're working, because students prepare the night before, So they come into the classroom having done homework. They're accountable for that homework. Often the system gives them immediate feedback in some way that they're learning. It might take one student 20 minutes. It might take one student 30 minutes, an hour, 3 hours. But when they come into that classroom, they're ready now to integrate that information, to collaborate. And the key is that they're practicing it. They're not just listening. They're practicing and doing something with it. So yes, that is, all of those things are true. But the reason that these classrooms are working is partly the community that forms that helps with some of the social issues, but also the amount of practice that they're doing.
Can I ask a question on this? So for like underrepresented groups and first generation students on campus, is there a community that supports them?
Mm-hmm. That's a great question. So there's Carolina Firsts, and that's run through the Office of Retention. And about 20% of our students are first-generation college students. UNC has a nice big population of first-generation college students. The Office of Retention is a place that would is a good go-to place right away. And I put it on, I think it's towards the back. This is the last bullet point. Office of Retention has many projects that focus on science students, so they focus specifically on STEM transfer students as a population they're worried about. So community college transfer students often come in not prepared for the rigor of Carolina. They certainly track underrepresented minority students. Rural students, we have a large population of rural students here that they worry about first-generation college. So they have a lot of data about those students that they can share, and they often have projects they're already working on that you can probably also plug into. And we're tracking them in the classroom and success with graduation rates.
Denise Young, so your title is Director of Education and Planning, mm-hmm. right, at Moorhead Planetarium and Science Center. And it's really great to have Denise here talking because for many of you, I know from the audience members that there's a handful of you who are thinking about NSF career proposals. And you've already heard my song and dance, those of you among them, that we have 8 winners on campus this year, which just absolutely shatters whatever we've done before. And we have, the last I checked, the second most non-engineering career awards nationwide so far this cycle, which is just really phenomenal. And Denise's broader impacts activities at Moorhead Planetarium and Science Center are partnered with 4 of those 8 winners. And we still have one last proposal pending, so I'm hoping it turns into 5. Mm-hmm. But particularly for the career people, listen up, but everybody else should listen up too.
Yeah,
so
everyone should listen up.
So Denise, please.
Yeah. Great, thank you. I have 2 messages today that I hope you will take with you as you start planning your next NSF proposal. And one is that broader impacts is increasingly serious business with the National Science Foundation. I think we've been hearing that for a long time, but there are now some kind of structural things in place with NSF that all directorates are starting to get a message about. I'll share that information with you today, at least at a high level, and tell you where you can get some more information about that. And then the second message is that Moorhead Planetarium and Science Center is a resource for you. And just a show of hands, anybody been to Moorhead Planetarium? Oh, yay. Okay, so great. I'm really glad. If you haven't been recently, I encourage you to come. And for those of you who have been, come back and see us again soon. So just to make sure we're all clear about what broader impacts is, it is an activity or planned experience, engagement, action, function that is conducted over a finite period of time, typically the time of your, the time frame of your proposal, for a specific purpose and with a target audience. And broader impacts can mean a variety, take a lot of different forms. So broader impacts could be the research itself. So if you are doing research that is going to protect public health, is going to lead to prevention or a cure for a disease, for example. The research itself is going to improve and impact society. That serves as a broader impact. Also, activities that are directly related to your specific research projects. So if you, as part of your research, are creating a new software package to do some sort of analysis, if you make that software package available to your professional community, that's a broader impact. So think about that. Kind of depends on what your research is, but that could be a broader impact. And then, of course, activity supported by and complementary to your project. A lot of the things we heard today related to teaching, things Kelly talked about, Leslie, QEP, course development. But what I'm here to talk about is outreach with K-12, general public, and the general public. Before I tell you a little bit more about Moorhead, here are some examples of broader impacts. These come directly from the NSF grant proposal guidelines. So if you have not looked at this list, please do. NSF has resources to support all of us as we're considering what we might do and how we might shape our broader impacts. And I also want to let you know that NSF has funded what is called the National Alliance for Broader Impacts. This is a group that is separate from the NSF, but is providing advice and guidance to NSF about broader impacts. And what this group has done is comprised of public communications specialists, research specialists, people who manage grants at universities across the country. And their job or their task is to provide input and guidance to the National Science Foundation regarding broader impacts. They have recently published what are called the guiding principles. That this document is now going to all of the program officers. It is going to review panels and will be used as a basis for decision making regarding grant proposal. So it's somewhere in the works there. The document's been created. It's in the process of getting distributed to NSF. Now, how seriously program officers and panelists take it, I think it's dependent on directorates and individual program officers. But NSF is putting a lot of resources behind broader impacts and trying to make broader impacts something that agency-wide is considered to be important and supported. So in this document, the guidelines, there are five guiding questions that the National Alliance for Broader Impact says that program officers and review panels should consider when evaluating the broader impacts portion of our proposals. The first one is, what is the potential of the proposed activity to benefit society and contribute to achievement of specific desired societal outcomes? And some of the things that they're looking at are, who is your audience? And are you looking at a deep dive with a small audience? Or are you looking at a broad brush stroke with a larger audience? And how scalable is what your broader impact activity is? Also, they say one of the guiding questions is, to what extent do the proposed activities suggest and explore creative, original, or potentially transformative concepts? They really want us as professionals to think about evidence-based practices. So some of the research that Kelly was citing is evidence-based research about practice, the practice of teaching STEM in a higher education setting. For me, working with K-12 audiences, I'm looking at the best practice literature regarding science instruction at that level. I'm looking at research about what works and doesn't work with general public audiences that come to Moorhead Planetarium and Science Center. But they want us to connect what we do to evidence-based practice. I think there are different levels of acceptance or support for original or creative or highly transformative. Different program officers feel differently about that, and I think the best advice is to talk with a program officer about what you're proposing for broader impacts and whether that would be acceptable in their eyes. And then another guiding question that panelists and program officers are being asked to consider is the plan for carrying out your broader impact activity well-reasoned, well-organized, and based on a sound rationale? And does it incorporate a mechanism to assess success? So we heard a little bit about that earlier, that you have to clearly define your target audience, what you want them to learn or take from the experience, and then have a way to evaluate that and report that back to the NSF. The last two questions are, how well qualified is the individual, team, or institution to conduct the proposed activity? So they're looking at your qualifications as a PI. If you don't have any experience doing broader impacts, then what they're looking for is that you're partnering with people who do have that experience. So partnerships can be incredibly valuable in the broader impacts portion. And then finally, are you putting adequate resources into your broader impacts plan? And that is, you know, of course, money, but also time. That could be your time, your graduate student's time. That could be time that you might support with someone else on campus, whether it's for evaluation or educators at Moorhead. But are you thinking through how this is really, how you're going to really make your broader impacts happen? So on to Moorhead Planetarium and Science Center. Many of you know Moorhead, so I won't spend a whole lot of time, but I do want to make sure you know that Moorhead is a part of the UNC. We're a department of the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. We're actually part of the infrastructure that exists to support you in telling the story of your research and the importance of your research to society, to the public. Moorhead's been open since 1949. It's the first planetarium built on a college campus anywhere in the world, and only the sixth that had been built in the United States at the time. We trained all of the Apollo era astronauts at Moorhead, so we call them our alumni. We don't graduate students the way you do in your departments, but we call the NASA astronauts from that time period our alums. And our expertise is really in science communication. So science communication, science education, and from cradle, my former boss used to say from birth to death. So we have programs for preschoolers. We have programs at senior centers that get people interested, excited, engaged in the STEM fields, and increasingly in STEAM, as we heard earlier. A lot of people don't know that while we are a planetarium, we also have an expanded mission to communicate science, technology, and health using the unique resources at UNC. So you are just as likely to walk into Moorhead and get a program about chemistry or the human body. Right now, our newest production is about flight. We have an exhibit that was connected to the water to the water theme on campus. So we go well beyond astronomy. And in the past 15 years, and this is as far back as I can find records, we have done broader impacts, NSF broader impacts collaborations with over 100 researchers. And we're going to be adding four more that have just recently been funded through CAREER. And we've certainly partnered with more researchers than that, but in terms of a defined relationship around NSF broader impacts, about 100 researchers. So we are eager to partner with you. If on the sheet that Kelly was having us do some reflection on, if you were interested in working with K-12, with teachers at the elementary, middle school, high school level, if you're interested in working with a general public audience, that could include, you know, again, preschool through senior citizens, we probably have a program that we could work on with you. What we do, in terms of starting collaboration and following it all the way through to conclusion, is start with a consultation where we find out what you're passionate about. I firmly believe it's got to fit what it is that you want to do, and what you're going to be interested in, and that your interest will be sustained over time. And together we'll come up with a broader impact activity that will work for both of us. We will provide assistance writing the broader impacts portion of the narrative. We'll provide budget information, budget justification, letters, all those sorts of things. And then once you're funded, we will implement the broader impact activity, and then we will conduct the evaluation as well for NSF reporting, and we'll hand you a report that you can just attach to your annual report. Just a couple quick examples of projects that we've done. Casey Miller in environmental sciences and engineering. Kathleen actually facilitated this happening through Moorhead with an NSF project, NSF-funded project. We created an exhibit, a 900-square-foot exhibit related to his research about how researchers are remediating the environment from tar deposits in the soil. That doesn't sound like it'd be a really interesting hands-on interactive exhibit, but through work with him, his staff, Kathleen and her staff, we came up with, I think, a really exciting way to engage students in tar remediation. I can't remember the numbers, but maybe 40,000 people interacted with that exhibit in the time it was on the floor. Yeah, so that's one of the things we'll discuss. This one was up for about a year and a couple months, so, and then we change it out. Ty Hedrick in the biology department, he did some. So I should say the exhibit project with Casey was all behind the scenes work. So he didn't come give talks to the public or teach programs to third graders or anything like that. It was all advisory behind the scenes, helping us get artifacts when we needed them and such, reading scripts before we spent a lot of money putting them on graphic panels. Ty's project is ongoing. In fact, we had a group of fourth graders in the building today who were participating in a pilot of a new class that we're developing, and our evaluator was there taking copious notes to deliver back to our education staff. But we connected his research to a new planetarium show production, Take Flight, about the four forces of flight that just opened. And we already had funding at Moorhead for the show, so he provided content expertise to this show script, developed his funding was to develop school-based programming to accompany that show when students came on a field trip. And then he's doing some direct interaction with the public through some family science programs. And then lastly, many of you know Sam in the Eshelman School of Pharmacy. We developed behind the scenes work as well, a curriculum called What's Not to Like. So he studies mucus, or it was during for that project. And so we had a little fun with that. This is a curriculum that goes to middle school teachers. It's aligned with the national curricular standards, which is really important when we're talking about working directly with school children. And then Sam and his graduate and undergraduate students have been going out into the community to participate in programs and taking things like Fakes Not. So, again, just to reiterate what's already been said today, think as you're thinking about the development of the broader impacts portion of your proposal, think about what it is you're interested in and passionate about. Think about how much time and budget you can allocate to your broader impacts activity. I think it's great to get some guidance from your program officer about what the expectations are there. And then do you prefer working directly with the public or working behind the scenes? You should do what we might push you a little bit on working directly with the public, because most people who do it find out it's a lot of fun once they get over the fear of fourth graders. But if you prefer to work behind the scenes, we certainly have opportunities there. And then if you are thinking that you might like to talk some more, just contacting me is the best way to do that. We typically start with a consultation. I prefer it not to be the week before your product proposal is due. The best ones, and I think we started really early with those career ones, and that's one of the reasons they were successful, is that I wasn't running around with my staff, you know, the 11th hour trying to put something together. It was clearly thoughtful. Probably were, what, 2 months in advance?
Say, well, we
3 months?
Some of those
yeah.
might have been 3 months out. Yeah.
Yeah. So, because it's not a 10-minute conversation and then we go. We probably need, you know, a couple different meetings to get that hammered out before we can move over to email. And what I brought to share with you is just a little more information about Morehead. And researchers have found the insert particularly helpful. It's a list of possibilities, and all this is possibilities. It's a starting place of the different kinds of outreach that you might do through Morehead, with a description of what it is, who the intended audience is, the project duration. So that's something else important to think about. You know, if you're writing a 3-year versus a 5-year proposal, and how much of your time you have to commit, and then the approximate cost. And these are all just starting places, but I find that it is helpful to at least have a starting place as you're starting to think about what you might like to do. Should also say that Morehead is not the only game in town when it comes to working with the general public or teachers. Kathleen is with the Institute for the Environment, the Environmental Resource Program, and she, I know, is happy to talk and do the same kinds of consultations. And there are others I'm sure we'll be hearing about over the next few community meetings. So that's